Okay, so let's go to this. The final section now we're in is called, we're going to talk about reality and truth, and you keep on mentioning that atheists borrow from the Christian worldview, so we can talk about that a bit. You know, I've seen you on some of the YouTube debates, and yeah, there's a lot of people. A lot of times, there are people talking over each other, and so hopefully, we can have more of a discussion here. And I think you'll find that I'm giving you some different answers than other atheists. So this should be interesting. Let me start off by saying one thing too. After I left the faith, one thing I really studied was critical thinking. And here's a book. It's called. I found out from Portland State University. I know a professor there. I asked them for a recommendation on a book on critical thinking because I wanted to help teach it to some other atheists. And he suggested this book, How to Think About Weird Things, Critical Thinking for New Age. It's written by two philosophy professors. And this book, I would say, is my new Bible because it teaches you how to think.
So you're religious?
Sure. It doesn't bother me to say that.
A lot of professed atheists don't like being called religious.
It's because of the definition of religion, so it doesn't bother me
because
I understand
That's
what you're
fine.
Talking about.
That's
so.
Fair.
So with this being my new Bible, here's the atheist evangelist and the Christian evangelist. So let's have a discussion on what is truth and all that. So
sure.
I'll let you ask me the questions and stuff and see if we have a different dialogue. We're not going to talk over each other. And
That's
all
fair.
That, so.
Okay. So as a Christian, I say truth is whatever conforms to the mind of God. On a very basic level, truth is
okay.
whatever God says.
Okay.
Now, I'm not opposed to the definition that most professed atheists give. Is truth is that which comports to reality.
And the dictionary definition.
Well, the thing is, there's many people have correspondence theory of truth, people have coherence theory of truth, but the correspondence theory of truth is the one that is probably most adhered to.
And you can call it the dictionary definition.
Well, not
too.
Necessarily, because there's many different dictionary definitions of truth.
I know, but I mean, if you look on dictionary.com, if you look at just any...
But people who don't adhere to the correspondence theory of truth will say, well, that's not my definition. But I will grant that for the purpose of this discussion. Truth is that, and I have no problem with that. I believe truth is what is real. But here's the problem. We have different perceptions. So when we look at something, truth is that which corresponds to reality as according to who? As perceived by who? Because I might look at this book and I'll say, well, that looks like dark blue to me. And you say it looks like pink.
Oh, exactly, yeah.
So it's according to who? Now, now there's a definition of truth that I've heard which I think adds an unnecessary step. However, truth is that which corresponds to reality as perceived by God. See, I think that God does not need to perceive it in order to be true. That's why I say whatever conforms to the mind of God. But God, according to the Christian worldview, is the perfect perceiver. So that's what we can have a correspondence theory of truth. However, the correspondence theory of truth fails among finite, fallible people because we have different perceptions. Our perceptions aren't perfect. I mean, if you look at this light for a minute and you turn away and close your eyes, you'll see a glow. You think that you see something there. It's not there. So truth is that which corresponds to reality, not according to finite, fallible people, according to an infallible perceiver, which is God. And I'm saying that's where the correspondence theory of truth fails with atheists, or professed atheists.
But yeah, I don't think it fails.
Okay, but that's fine. So you agree that truth is that which corresponds to reality?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay,
right.
How do you know what's real?
Now, that's a really good question, because actually, and in this book, they actually come up with, they answer this question. You know, in general, there's two kinds of different thinking, too. There's like what they call scientific thinking, and there's magical thinking. And scientific thinking actually answers your question.
Great, I'm looking forward to the answer.
Okay, so for example, here's the general way to approach any question. Like, for example, the question is, does God exist? Okay, what you do is you have different hypotheses, and then what you want to do is you want to say, how can I judge those hypotheses for the best... What's the best hypothesis? In this book, it lays down five criteria. For example, one of them is the ability to make predictions. One of them is simplicity. As far, you know, in other words, one that, according to Occam's razor, where you don't hypothesize extra things. So for example, if you say, I think there's a gremlin that makes the fluorescent light go on, and somebody else says, no, I think there's five of them. Somebody else says, no, I think there's 10 of them. Somebody else says, no, I think there's 10 gremlins plus a djinn plus a demon. You know, so the less you put on there, the more likely you are to get the truth because there's less
like add-ons. Occam's razor says do not add entities beyond that which
right.
is necessary.
Right.
However, you cannot also subtract entities beyond what's necessary. So that's what I'm saying. So I mean, I'm sure you're going to get to my question, but how do you know what's real? You're telling me how people answer questions. I don't mind that you formulate it, but I hope that you do get to the answer to that question.
Okay. So basically, it is all about observations, but there's also independent observations. And so, for example, in science, we've learned there's problems. For example, the placebo effect is something that's learned. So when they do testing, they test against a placebo to see if you say you have a miracle cure, we test it against a placebo to make sure this miracle cure is not a placebo. Then what if the doctor gives a hint out? Well, then we have blind testing. Well, what if or what if the patient found out? So then what if the doctor found out? You have double blind testing.
Well, here's the problem.
So double blind testing, placebo, all these things, what they do is they eliminate the subjectiveness.
Here's the problem. I ask you how you know that your reasoning is valid. Mm-hmm. Your sense of reasoning is valid. You know what you're saying? Well, I use my sense and reasoning.
Yeah.
That's a vicious circle. You're appealing to your sense and reasoning to prove your sense of...
But what do you mean by vicious
circle? Here's the question, though. If your reasoning was not valid, how would you know it?
It'd be very easy.
No, if it was not valid, would it not logically follow that you would need valid reasoning to conclude that your reasoning was not valid?
Sure.
So let's say you were a person who could not ever reason to logical conclusions. How would you know that?
Because I talked to somebody else and they would give me a reason why.
But then you're assuming valid reasoning. That's the problem. See, because if your reasoning was not valid, there's no way you could know.
But everybody has valid reasoning to some extent.
Well, how do you know that?
Because for just to live in the world, I mean, for example, I drove in a car here. I
had
so many valid reasoning I had to do just to even drive
here. Here's the
here.
Problem. You're appealing to your senses and reasoning to know that you drove here. How do you know, like in the debate with Matt Dillahunty, that you're not a brain in a vat? That you never even drove here? That you're just being fed these things through a computer program?
Yeah.
How do you know? You have no idea. So you're appealing to your memory to prove your memory. You're appealing to your reasoning to prove your reasoning. You're appealing to your senses to prove your senses. That is a vicious circle. I'm saying without God, you can't get out of that circle.
Well, instead of a vicious circle, I mean, why not say it's a positive, powerful circle?
Because when you say that, I say, is that true?
Well, here's the reason why I could say it's a positive, powerful circle, because science is taking off like a rocket, and technology is exploding exponentially because of the more we rely on the scientific method, we're creating more technology.
Here's the problem with that.
And it's feeding back on itself, and that's why technology and science is growing exponentially, because it's so successful.
Let me show you the problem with that. That's what's called the fallacy of irrelevant theses. And because I say, how do you know your reasoning is valid? And you tell me all of these things that science has done.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the problem. And Jason Lyle came up with this example. Let's say that you are a reporter.
Jason who?
Jason Lyle. He's another presuppositional apologist, brilliant man. He wrote a book called The Ultimate Proof of Creation. I encourage people to check that out.
But by the way, can I ask you just a question background? I'm glad you refer to people because it's interesting to do more background knowledge. Are there any philosophers that you...
Greg Bonson, Cornelius Van Til.
Okay.
Greg Bonson, I learned just about everything I've learned on the apologetic from Scripture and from Greg Bonson.
Okay.
But okay, so I asked you how your reasoning is valid and you gave me all these things that science has done. Now let's say you're a reporter hired to cover a plane crash,
mm-hmm.
and you went to this plane crash, and then you see among all this rubble and this burning debris, somebody comes stumbling towards you, their clothes all burnt, a survivor.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, sir, how is it possible that you survived this crash? And he said, you know what? If I didn't survive this crash, I couldn't be here talking to you. Look at all these things that I'm doing. Now that might be very true, and all these things you're saying are true about what science has done, but it's irrelevant to the question. I asked you, how do you know what is real? And you're saying, well, all these things that science has done. So I'm asking this fellow, how do you know you survived this plane crash? And he says, well, if I didn't, I couldn't have walked here from the plane crash. I couldn't be standing here talking to you. All of that's true, but irrelevant to the question. I want to know how you know what is real. And you're saying all these things that you can do because there is reality. This guy is saying all these things he can do because he's alive. But that has nothing to do with how he knows he survived the plane crash.
Well, first of all...
Or how he was able to survive the plane crash.
I think in your question, are you implying how do you know what's 100% real and certain?
How do you know what's real to any degree?
So basically, I would say all we have is beliefs.
Right.
And okay.
You have opinion, you have beliefs, you have arbitrary beliefs.
Well, beliefs based on evidence.
Well, here's the problem. When you say beliefs based on evidence, you're appealing to something that you can't account for.
What do you mean, what?
Well, evidence, for instance, demands truth. You cannot, evidence...
Evidence is what I touch and feel. Like, for example, there's evidence, there's books on this table.
But here's, how do you know that you're not, like I said with Matt Dillahunty, that you're not a brain in a vat somewhere? So you're saying this is real.
There's a possibility of that, right.
Right, so therefore, if truth is that which corresponds to reality, and you can't know what's real, you can't know what's true, and therefore this discussion makes no sense.
We can't know for 100%.
You can't know to any degree. How do you know this is real to any degree?
Because I can feel it.
Okay, but how do you know that your sense and how do you know you're not a brain in a vat to any degree?
I know. I mean, I could be. This could all be a dream.
Right. So to any degree.
Here's the problem.
Well, first of all, you're positing. So I don't. And I'm saying you don't either because
This could be your dream.
Well, here's
also
the question: can God make me certain of things?
Of course not.
Why not? The all-knowing, all-powerful creator of this world cannot make his creatures certain of some things. Why can't you do that?
Are you certain that humans did not descend from other animals?
My question. See, that's the problem.
I mean,
you say we're going to talk about this in the other section. This is the last section.
Right.
Can God make us certain of things?
I don't believe God exists.
But according to the Christian worldview, God who created us, who is all-powerful, all-knowing, can he make creatures who are certain of things?
If there was a God that existed like that,
right,
and he willed that, yes.
Okay, so according to my worldview, I have a foundation for certainty. You might disagree with that. That's fine. But you've admitted that you can have none. That you don't know if you're a brain in a vat. And I'm saying you, as a professed unbeliever, also know that God exists. When you appeal to things, when you say, this is real, I'm saying you're appealing to the God that made you. Because that is inconsistent with your worldview.
I don't think it's inconsistent at all.
Well, that's fine. How do you know what's real? On a very basic level, how do you know what's real when you could be a brain in the vat?
Well,
to any degree, to 0.0001%, how do you know this table is here when you could be a brain
in
the vat?
I don't know 100%.
No, I'm asking you, how do you know to 0.00001% that this table is real?
Because I can touch it and feel it. And plus, I have independent observation from other people.
Here's the thing, though. If you're a brain in the vat, that independent observation could all be fed to you from a computer program. So you can't know to 0.001% that is not the case. So when I ask you how you know anything to 0.001%...
No, first of all, the numbers make no percentage. You can't say 0.001. Those are calculations.
Okay,
those are calculations on statistics. You can't just pull numbers out
of the
air.
So you believe that knowledge must be certain? Knowledge must be true?
No, I don't go for certainty at all. Like I said, I think we both agreed that everything is about your belief systems. We all have beliefs based on...
I believe I can have certainty, and you conceded according to my worldview. I can.
According to your worldview, yes, but I think your worldview is false.
However, you have no basis for calling something true or false. Because again, we can backtrack. You say, I believe your worldview is false. That appeals to a standard of truth. And I say, how do you know what's true? And you say, truth is that which is real. And I say, how do you know what's real? And you can't give me an answer. Because you don't know that this is real to any degree.
I don't think anybody knows that they're not,
but
this is not a dream, for example.
The problem with that is that's a knowledge claim.
That's my belief.
It's my belief. So you're just giving me opinion. You're not telling me what's true or false.
That's my belief based on my experience. Right.
So, but my experiences could be all fictitious.
Right. I could learn something tomorrow and say, I was totally wrong.
So we're not discussing truth or falsehood. Now we're talking your belief system, your arbitrary belief system.
Everybody who talks is always talking about their beliefs.
Okay, is that true or do you believe that?
I believe that, yeah.
Okay, so we're talking opinion. You know what the Bible says about opinion?
Everybody,
Proverbs 18, verse 2.
No, everybody.
The fool does not delight in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. And that's what you're doing.
But everybody has opinions.
Everybody has opinions. However, when you say everyone has opinions, you're making a truth claim. Now I say, is it true that everyone has opinion? You have to say, no, it's my opinion. And then we're in the realm of absurdity again.
I don't think it's absurd. I think
is it true that you don't think it's absurd? Or is it your opinion that you don't think it's absurd?
Okay. True versus true or false. So when you say it again,
everything that you say depends on truth and knowledge. When you have conceded that everything is just a belief system, and that's the contradiction in atheism. Because you will appeal to the God, to the ultimate standard of truth, knowledge, logic, reason, induction, which we haven't gotten back to yet. I say, how do you know that the words you're about, let's go there for a minute. How do you know that the words you're about to speak mean the same thing they did 5 seconds ago? And you say we're going to get to that the other section. So you're appealing to what's called induction. Now, David Hume could not solve the problem of induction. Well-known atheist. He has no basis for assuming the future is going to be like the past. Do you know what professed unbelievers
say? Well, so basically, when you say he cannot solve it, basically what you're saying is induction is just...
There is no solution outside of God.
It's basically what you're saying is it's an axiom. You can't justify it, but
right.
It's an axiom that we build upon, and everything works out from there.
Here's the problem, though. I would say, according to an atheist, Are all axioms valid? Are all axioms true? And you'd have to say, well, no, I don't know.
I would say you can put them to the test. And this is why science...
Axioms you cannot put to the test.
Sure you can.
That's the whole definition of axioms. They're not provable.
No, they are true. You can build a house upon them, and if this falls, it'll cave in.
No, but that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the axiom itself is not provable.
Yeah, it is, because if you build, it's a foundation that you build upon, and if it falls, the foundation will collapse.
Okay, so what was your axiom? Your axiom is what? That induction is the case?
That we can know the world through our senses, and this is what the whole scientific enterprise is about, is how to best learn about the world through our, not only our senses, but also senses beyond our senses, like infrared things. We can see things that we can't see because of machines.
Now the problem is that you assume that the future will be like the past. Now, is that something you test, or is that an axiomatic belief?
It's from testing, it's from history, observation, and then sometimes, see, not everything is the same. Sometimes things do change. For example, if there's never an earthquake, we could say, like, well, the ground's never going to move. And then there's an earthquake, and you say, okay, you know what, we can never say the ground is never going to move, because now we know.
Let's get back to the original question. When you speak words into the atmosphere, mm-hmm. you assume that they're going to mean the same thing they did 5 seconds ago. Mm-hmm. What is the basis for that assumption?
Human experience.
Okay, so now what you're doing is you're saying it's always been like that. I'm asking you about the future, and you're giving me past events.
Right.
Now, let me explain on a very basic
term. That's very powerful.
Let me explain on a very basic term what inductive reasoning is. It's from the general to the specific, or from the past to the future. Okay, so would it not be fair to call inductive reasoning looking back at reasoning? If we're looking back to prove future events.
No, I think inductive reasoning is when you look at the world and make a prediction based on that.
Right, okay.
The common thing about there's no black swans.
Right. Okay, so you look back at all the swans you've seen to conclude that all swans are black. So it's
called... Or white.
Whatever, right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, okay.
And then you see the black swan and you say, okay, now we know...
Right, so what you're doing is looking back at. Mm-hmm. You're looking back at to prove future events. So on a very basic...
Looking back at evidence.
Right. We're looking back at evidence, whatever. Mm-hmm. So we're calling it looking back at reasoning. That's the kind of reasoning.
Now, looking back at evidence.
I'm
describing... Reasoning is done on evidence.
I'm not saying that we're looking back at reasoning. I'm describing the type of reasoning that we do when we reason inductively. I'm calling it looking back at. That's the type of reasoning we do. That's inductive reasoning. And I'm describing, it's called looking back at reasoning. Or if you want to make it simple, looking back at evidence reasoning.
Well, I mean, deductive logic you might be the same thing. I mean, you're just basing on building on facts.
Let me finish my point.
Okay.
Inductive reasoning, you're looking back at to prove future events. So I'm going to call it looking back at reasoning. And my question to you is, how do you know that inductive reasoning is valid? And you know what you do? You look back. You use the very thing that you're trying to prove. You're using induction to prove induction, and again, it's a vicious circle.
It's not vicious, though. It's powerful. It's productive.
How do you know that the future will be like the past?
We don't know for sure.
You don't know to any degree.
But you know what? If we assume it, and we make predictions on that, and we depend on it, it turns out to be very successful.
However, when you say that, you're already using it.
Yeah, we're using it, but it turns out to be powerful. That's why it's so powerful. If it wasn't powerful, people would say, don't use inductive reasoning. It sucks. It doesn't do the job.
The problem.
But the reason, it does the job perfectly. That's why it's so strong.
Here's the difference between you and I. I believe in inductive reasoning. Because I believe in God who made this world uniform such that we can reason in it. But I ask, on what basis do you assume the future can be like the past? You have to look at the past. And that's a vicious circle. I believe inductive reasoning is powerful, but I can account for it in my worldview. Because God has created this world uniformly. But you don't know that logic will exist 2 seconds from now.
No, wait. In your worldview, God did not create the world uniformly. He created Adam and Eve looking like he was of age and ready to reproduce when in fact he was one day old.
Well, the thing is, I'm not going to argue. It makes no sense to...
That blows away your induction.
No, here's the thing. It makes no sense to redefine my worldview. God created the world the way he did it uniformly. Creating Adam as an adult does not refute induction. Yeah. God is control of this universe.
Yeah, that breaks induction.
No, it doesn't.
If you looked at Adam, you would not say this guy is one day old. You would say he's 13 years old.
That does not do with induction. If God creates something as someone as a man, that doesn't refute induction.
Well, when you see a man, you figure, well, he's obviously been around a bunch of years because from induction we know how things grow. But yet that's totally broken.
No, Adam, he was the first man.
Yeah, I know. But if you just met him and you had inductive logic...
How can you meet him if you're the first man, if he's the first man?
If you're the second man and you met him.
He was a child of the first man.
Okay, but let's say you have a video camera.
God does something a certain way.
Right.
Created it. But that doesn't refute induction. God does things the way. So according to the Christian worldview,
that destroys every kind of logic, deductive and deductive logic.
Well, it doesn't for the Christian, because here's the thing: I have the absolute foundation for which I say things are true and false. Now you say that destroys logic, right? You say it destroys induction. Now is that your opinion? Is that your belief, or is that true?
Well, your
hang on. Is that your belief that it destroys logic and induction, or is that true?
Well, I would say it's true according to my beliefs.
Yeah, but the thing,
true versus false.
Hang on 1 second. Now listen, I want to get back on that thing you said. True according to my beliefs. Mm-hmm. That means truth is relative. Do you believe truth is relative?
No. I agree with you. The ultimate truth is not relative, but we're all trying to find the truth.
But true according to your beliefs is a nonsensical statement, because truth is not relative.
No, you asked.
So I ask you, is it true? And all you're saying is, I believe it.
Well, we're all trying to search for the truth.
Okay, what is truth then? You can't search for truth if you don't have a justification for knowing your reasoning is valid, for truth, for logic. Logic is universal, you'd agree with that. Logic is not made of matter. Logic does not change. According to atheism, how do you get a universal, abstract, invariant law?
Well, there's a lot of things we don't know. We don't know how the Big Bang came about.
You live on faith.
Even philosophers say they argue about, you know, whether numbers exist.
So you have faith in logic. You have faith in induction.
I mean, for example, like, do numbers exist? Does the number 2 exist? Somebody says, like, well, yeah, of course.
There's the
two pencils, 1, 2. Yeah, there's a 2, but it's like you don't see a 2 anywhere in nature. You don't see a number 2 or anything.
You know what that does? It refutes atheism.
It's just that philosophy is much deeper than simplistic thinking. For example, time even.
Where is the number 2?
For example, in time, you know, people had a more simplistic idea of time before Einstein's general theory of relativity. He said there's a space-time fabric and time can be warped. This is mind-boggling to people who had a simplistic idea that, oh, time's just, you know, tick, 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 it's always the same. It's not.
Where is the number 2 in atheism? Where is it? Two-ness.
As far as I know, it's a concept.
It's a concept.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you account for immaterial concepts according to atheism?
Yeah, I don't know.
That's right. You have faith in that.
But I don't think appealing to magic is
well, it's not magic. Because the thing is, you believe in too. So your answer is, I just don't know. I have blind faith. Well, you have blind faith. And the interesting thing is, here's a Christian talking to
it's not
atheist.
Blind faith. No,
okay,
I don't
where's
know.
Number 2?
I said, I don't know. That's not blind faith. That's
but do you believe that there is, that 2 exists?
Like I said, I don't know. Philosophers argue about that. Whether numbers exist in
nature
or not.
On what basis do you believe in it if it's not faith?
On what basis do I
believe? You believe that 2 exists, if not faith.
Well, it depends on what you mean by exists. I mean, like, if there's 2 pencils...
You believe it's a concept. You believe that
it's a concept.
Two-ness is a concept.
Mm-hmm.
Where does that concept exist?
I don't know all the details.
Right, you have faith in it.
Like I said, the philosophers have deep philosophical arguments
they have faith.
Over it.
Outside of God, they have blind faith.
But, you know, for example, you can't say, like, well, who created the Big Bang?
I say
I don't know, and you say, okay, that's evidence for God.
I have not used that argument.
It's the same thing, though. You say, if I can't explain numbers, then God.
Well, here's the difference, because you're appealing to what's called the God of the Gaps argument, right?
I think you are. Yeah.
No, here's the problem. Let's say that I say to you, what's 2 plus 2,
mm-hmm.
and you say 4. I say, mm-hmm. 4 are the gaps. And you say, no, 4 is the right answer.
Yeah, because
so I'm not appealing to God of the Gaps.
Because I can demonstrate.
Here's the thing.
Because I can demonstrate.
I'm not appealing to God of the Gaps. I'm saying, no, God is the right answer, as he is revealed, as you know it as well. Because you cannot demonstrate that 2 plus 2 equals 4, because you can't account for 2.
No, I can demonstrate that.
You cannot account for 2-ness.
Sure I can.
Okay, where is 2 in the atheistic worldview? You went through that.
There's 2 books right here.
I'm not asking you for an actualization of the concept of 2.
Mm-hmm.
I'm asking you, where is 2-ness?
Yeah, and I'm saying I don't know all answers to that. And I think the smartest philosophers would probably argue it also.
The smartest non-Christian philosophers have no answer.
But you can't say, oh, you don't have an answer and I have an answer. God did it.
Well, I'm saying that I know for certain that God did it. And you conceded in the other video that I can know things for certain.
So why isn't that God of the Gaps?
Because you have conceded that I can have certain knowledge that God did this. Those concepts are within the mind of God. And I can have certain knowledge of that according to my worldview.
I said according to your worldview, yeah, of course, but I think your worldview is fantasy.
However, that being the case, I have a foundation for which, according to my worldview, I can have certainty, and I ask you, where is two-ness? I don't know. You have faith.
But having a foundation
that is what you contrast
having a foundation doesn't mean anything, though. I mean, you can have a foundation in Star Wars, in the Quran, or whatever. Just because you have a foundation doesn't mean it's superior.
You're saying that having a foundation doesn't mean anything. Is that true? Or is that your belief?
That's my belief.
Okay, so you're just telling an arbitrary belief.
Based on all my experience, yeah.
Right, which, okay, mm-hmm. Now is it true that that's your belief?
Yeah.
Okay, so now you're appealing to truth. Now you're not appealing to a belief system.
No, I'm saying my belief is true. It's true, that's my belief. It's not a lie, it's not a false.
Okay, it's true.
It's either true or false, and it's
okay.
True.
Okay, and how do you know it's true?
Because
truth
telling...
is that which corresponds to reality, and you don't know that this is the right reality.
Well, when I give my opinion and you ask me if it's true, that means that could mean, am I lying? Is it a truth? Am I telling a truth or am I lying?
But truth or falsehood makes no sense within the atheistic worldview. Evolved pond scum, and I've done this, I think I did it with Matt in the debate as well. According to atheism, you are a proponent of evolution. Right?
Sure, sure. Yeah.
So you believe that your brain on a very basic level.
You know, it's not just atheists. I mean, there's a lot of Christians that accept evolution also.
That's fair. You know, and I would have difficulty with theistic evolution. However, according to your worldview, you believe on a very basic level that your brain is an evolved meat machine. Right? On a very basic level. Evolved meat computer.
Our brain is evolved and it's meat, yes.
Right, and you believe that your thoughts are the byproduct of whatever is happening in that evolved brain, that electrical chemical process.
Right, right,
that's
right.
What your thoughts are.
Right.
And Doug Wilson came up with this experiment, and he says, let's say you take a bottle of Dr. Pepper and a bottle of Mountain Dew, and you shake them, and you open them, they start to fizz.
Yeah.
Which of those fizzes would be true? It's a nonsensical question, correct?
No, it was a nonsensical
example. Well, let me finish the analogy, because that fizz is the byproduct of the reactions, you know, on a very basic level.
Sure.
Now, my question, as an atheist who professes evolution, on what basis do you assume that your brain fizz corresponds to reality, that is true? Where do you get truth from brain fizz?
Okay, see, the thing is, though, that question shows, the person asking that question shows a huge amount of scientific ignorance.
Well, you're just fizzing. Is that true, or are you fizzing?
Hold on. It shows an incredible amount of ignorance about neurology, because brain thinking happens with chemical reactions with neurons.
Right.
There's no neurons in pop.
What I said is at a very basic level, but what I want you to tell me is those chemical reactions within your meat machine, how do you know that they're true, that they correspond to reality to any degree? Where do you get truth?
Through the scientific method and scientific thinking.
But you're using that fizz.
Like I told you in this
you're
book.
You're just fizzing through scientific method. You're saying you're fizzing this book.
It's not fizzing.
What is it?
The brain is not fizzing. There's neurons.
Right. Okay, the neurons. So neurons, synapses are firing.
Yeah, they have what they call brain traces and things.
And how do you know that those things are corresponding to reality? You have no idea.
Because of the scientific method.
How do you know the scientific method is valid?
Because of success.
Okay, now when you test the success of the scientific method, are you using the scientific method?
Yeah.
Okay, that's the problem. It's a vicious circle.
It's not vicious, though. It's powerful. It's powerful and very productive.
Okay, is it true that it's powerful, or is that your belief?
It's my belief, of course. Everything's my belief.
That's right.
Yeah, and based on my evidence, right.
It's your
if you see a chart, you can see how science and technology has exponentially grown. I mean,
doesn't it
blow you away how amazing technology. I work in the computer field.
Right. And you can only do that because you know God exists. You can only do computer science because you know God exists, because you cannot make sense of induction.
But do you agree just in the last 50 years how technology has
praise
exploded?
God. Praise God.
But you acknowledge that, right?
Absolutely.
It's kind
praise
of mind-boggling
God.
How
it's
technology.
Amazing. Praise God.
That's because of the success of scientific thinking.
Which God enables to happen, which God allows to happen. Science makes no sense outside of God because you appeal to induction, which you have admitted you can't justify. You take it on faith.
I don't think you need to. I can justify it based on the success of it.
Yeah, but then you're assuming it. You're assuming
induction. No, I'm judging. I'm judging it by the success.
Right.
I'm saying, okay, look, some guy says, I have induction. Some other guy says, oh, I have the divine words of God. I'm a prophet. Okay, let's put them both to test.
No, no. What I'm
and
saying...
what happens is, see, let's go to a war.
You don't have induction.
Okay, let me give you an example.
All right.
We go to war. Okay, somebody says, I have these science and technology. Let's build a nuclear bomb or something even more powerful. This other guy says, no, we're going to cast some demons and cast a curse on it. Okay, let's try it. The group that does casting curses and stuff, they're going to get demolished because
here's
reality shows that that doesn't work.
Here's the problem. You don't have science and induction without God. You don't have that. You're appealing to God for your science and induction. The thing is, you suppress the truth about it. Science and induction make no sense. And the example that I give is, let's say that I'm going to go to war with another nation, and I have all the ammunition. When does that war start? When I give them some ammunition. I'm not giving the unbeliever science and knowledge and logic and truth. I'm saying those things belong to Jesus Christ. So when you use those things to argue against, and when you use science and reason and logic, you're borrowing concepts that you cannot justify. You say, we just don't know. You have blind faith in a system that does not start with God.
No, I don't know is not faith in something. I don't know means I'm open to understanding.
Okay, so then on what basis, if you do not know, on what basis do you affirm them?
On the results.
Okay, now, so you're a pragmatist.
Sure, of course.
Okay, now here's the problem with pragmatism. Mm-hmm. Pragmatism can tell you many things. How something is supposed to work, how something works, or if it works, it can't tell you how something's supposed to work. And this is the example I give. Let's say you're out of work. Mm-hmm. You lost your job at that, you know, at that computer software place or so. And I happen to own the local Blark factory.
And what factory?
Blark factory.
Okay.
And you come in and I say, you know what your job is? I'm gonna make you a quality control of Blarks. And I give you this white lab coat and I put you in this room with a conveyor belt. And out come these things on this conveyor belt. And I say, sir, it's your job to tell me whether or not these Blarks work. Mm-hmm. What's your first question?
What are the specifications?
What's a Blark?
Right? Yeah. Or well, I'll say, what are the specifications?
Right. I say, well, that's the Blark there. So you're going to ask me, how is a Blark supposed to work? Mm-hmm. Right?
Right, right.
Pragmatism cannot tell you that. Pragmatism can tell you if something works or not. It cannot tell you how something's supposed to work.
Pragmatism is what makes me ask the question. What are the specs? Well, because I want to be a pragmatist. I want to do my job.
Here's the question, though. Pragmatism, you would agree that pragmatism is determining whether or not something works. I believe this because it works. Mm-hmm. Pragmatism cannot tell you how something's supposed to work.
Well, I guess you need a better example because I didn't see it from that example.
Well, in that Blark factory example, I say, you're supposed to tell me if this works or not. You have to, how's it supposed to work?
Yeah,
You cannot tell me how something's supposed to work, if something works or not. You cannot tell me if something works or not unless you know how it's supposed to work.
Okay,
pragmatism cannot give you that.
But what if, for example, we said, here's Blark 1 and here's Blark 2. Right. We want you to test them to find out which is the better one. How would you test them? You would say, let's design a test course, and you would find out which one operates better, and that's a pragmatist approach, to find out which one is better because which one performed better.
Okay, now you make a very important point here, to see which one is better.
Yeah.
You cannot determine if one is better than the other one unless you have a standard that they come closer to.
Right.
What is that standard in pragmatism? You don't know.
No. That's why I said in this book, there's five criteria to use. For example, simplicity, conservatism, which means it lines up with, the hypothesis lines up with established knowledge.
Okay, but the thing is, you don't know if something's simple if you don't know how it's supposed to work. Say, which one is simpler than the other? Let's say that these things are very complex things, and what the designer made it for? As a doorstop. And one happens to be a little bit heavier, and the other one's more complex or simpler or whatever, mm-hmm. and you think, well, this is the one that works. I say, well, actually, you know what they're designed for? They're supposed to be doorstops. Mm-hmm. So you can't tell me which one is the better one unless you know their purpose.
I agree, but once we know the purpose,
then we
test it to find out.
Right.
Pragmatist
cannot give you the purpose.
I know, but I don't think that God that you just randomly picked.
I don't randomly pick God.
Yeah, you did. You just randomly picked the Bible. You could have picked the Quran and had the same presupposition.
Well, we've gone through that already. However, you appeal to pragmatism and you admit that pragmatism cannot give you the purpose. Therefore, pragmatism fails.
Okay, I guess we'll have to agree to disagree. Okay, anything else you want to say in closing for this?
No, well, you know, I think that. And the number of times I encourage people to go back to these interview and look at, you know, how I ask them to account for truth, logic, induction, and to show that all of your accounts amounted to, well, I don't know. And, you know, of course, he denies that fact, but when you say, I don't know, you still believe them. There is a justification for them. In your case, it's faith. In my case, it's God. I know that God exists, therefore I can do science. Therefore, I can have truth, I can have knowledge, I can have reason. And I'm saying that you, who work in the computer field, do all these things. You do all these things because you're made in the image of God and you borrow from Him. That's why you're without excuse when you stand before Him. You can't stand before Him and say, I just didn't know. I say, every word out of your mouth shows that you knew because you appeal to induction. And you say, well, I'm not going to speak anymore. Every thought in your head appeals to induction. Everything you do exposes that you know the God and you're suppressing the truth. And like I say, atheists, when they become Christians, do not go from unbelief to belief. They go from suppressing the truth to professing the truth. And I'll pray for you, and I hope that you do that one day as well.
Okay.
By the grace of God, I hope He grants your repentance.
Well, let me give one little summary, too, and then I'll give you a comment. You can comment on that. I think it's all a matter of looking at and evaluating different hypotheses. And like I said, this book here talks exactly about how to evaluate different hypotheses on five different different points. So basically, the question is, does God exist? One hypothesis is yes, he is, does, and one is he doesn't. And then you can use these five criteria to examine them, and you need to figure out which makes the best sense according to these five criteria. So I think there definitely is a way to examine things, and there's no God required whatsoever.
Well, that process presupposes God.
Okay.
And it presupposes sense, it presupposes reasoning, it presupposes logic. All of these criteria that you're appealing to appeal to things that this book cannot account for, and this book does.
Okay, so I guess we agree to disagree there. All right, thanks.
All right, good to meet you. Thanks for the book.
Sure.